Good morning.
Good morning.
Ooh, good job on the first try. Pat yourself on the back. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Williams. If you didn't know where you are this morning, you are at Williams, the best place to worship. I think so. But if everyone could grab your bulletins really quick. And while you're doing that, I'm going to welcome our visitors. Welcome, visitors. If you are a visitor, we would love to get to know you. And one way we do that is have you fill out in the back of the bulletin. There's this little half sheet of paper flappy back and forth, and you rip it out. But first, we'd love for you to fill it out, all your information, and put it in the offering plate in a few minutes. If y'all could please do that, you visitors. Y'all are precious to us here at Williams. Now that everyone else has their bulletins, let me highlight a few things that are written inside this bad boy. Alrighty, tonight, we will not have worship. So you can spend that time dancing in the rain that's coming. That sounds good. Or you could spend it with family, whatever you would like to do. Just please spend that time wisely. Come back this Wednesday, not back here, but at the SHU residence. And if you look on the insert in your bulletin, it has all the information, the address. It will start at 6:30. We're going to have a house dedication at the Shoes. And we're also going to do the same thing that we did at the McGinnis home, where we write scripture, even some little notes of encouragement on their framing of their home. So that was really awesome to do at the McGinnises, and it's going to be the same way at the Shoes. So if you missed out, make sure that you come this Wednesday at 6:30, come to the Shoes for the dedication there. Also, there are some trips going on. If you look above that little note in the insert, read about that. There are sign-up sheets around here and some foyers. We've got plenty of foyers. And then on the next sheet there is the deacon nomination form, and actually today is the day you need to get this in. So if you could spend some time and fill that out and turn that in if you have not done so already. And also, just to make sure, here is our calendar for this September. Take this home and do as I do and put it on your refrigerator, because that's the place that I visit the most. And you can see what's going on at the church. I need to meet with all of my parents, my youth parents, my youth, and any college and career person that might be interested in going to a Braves game in a few weeks. So meet me right after the service this morning, okay? And one quick note, children's choir will start next Sunday at 5 o'clock. So any of you that are in the choir already that meet and have some children that you know, bring them with you, drop them off. Or if you have a child that loves to sing, bring them 5 o'clock next Sunday. Alrighty, now you know what time it is, my favorite time. It's time to love, it's time to kiss, time to hug. Let's do it. Find someone and say good morning.
Morning. Today's call to worship scriptures comes from Jonah 4, 10, and 11. Then said the Lord, Thou hast had pity on the gourd, for the which thou hast not labored, neither made it grow, which came up in the night and perished in a night. And should not I spare Nineveh, that great city, wherein are more than 60,000 persons that cannot discern between their right hand and their left hand? And also much cattle.
spotlight's a little bright on me. Folks complaining about the glare. The other way, please. Thank you, sir. Well, good morning. It's good to see you. It's just good to be in worship at Williams. And I'd like to encourage you, if you would, to get your hymn book and join in the singing. I think you know the hymns today. Our first hymn, 43, Great is Thy Faithfulness, Lord, unto me. 43, stand with us, please. All three standers. Join us as we sing.
Thank you. Okay, listen carefully as I read from our missions moment this morning. It's Psalm 82, 3 through 5. Listen carefully. Give justice to the weak and the orphan. Maintain the right of the lowly and destitute. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They have neither knowledge nor understanding. They walk around in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. 14 foster children live with loving Christian families in the Village of Hope in Buka, Ukraine. Some of these children were abandoned. Some were street children. Some were living in the orphanages of Ukraine. They represent thousands of children in need of a home and a family. Pray that more foster families will take street children and orphans in Ukraine. Pray that CBF partner churches will continue to give sacrificially to help support the neglected and abandoned children in the Village of Hope. Pray for Jenny and Mina Podowski, CBF personnel ministering to children at risk in Kiev, Ukraine. Bow with me for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for these that are reaching out to the poorest and the most needy people in this world, Lord, and we just pray that you would put on our hearts, Lord, to reach out in whatever ways that we can. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good today?
Good. We're not going to have children's church today because Brock's sick, and so we won't have our leader today. So we'll hope Brock gets to feeling better next week. But I was going to tell you a little bit about the story that I'm going to preach about today. We've been going through a lot of stories from the Bible, especially the Old Testament. And this is a really neat story that a lot of people know about. Has anybody ever heard of a guy named Jonah? Anybody ever heard of Jonah? Okay. What else? What else do you know about Jonah? He hates those people. That's right. He was very upset and angry. God told him to go tell some people, his enemies, some news that God had for him. What did Jonah do instead of doing that? Does anybody know? What did he get on? He went the opposite way. He did. What did he just go the opposite way? What did he get on to go away? He got on a boat. He got on a big ship. And then what happened to the ship in the water? Do you remember? It sunk. Well, it didn't sink, but it nearly sunk. There was a big storm, and then there was a bunch of sailors on that ship, and they were scared because they thought it was going to sink. So what did they do to Jonah? Does anybody know? Threw him in the water. They did. They threw him in the water. It's a strange story in a way. But then what happened to the water when they threw him in the water? The water got calm again. What happened to Jonah? What ate him? Big fish came along and ate him up. So here's our story. This is a picture that I have here from a little storybook that tells about the Bible. And this is Jonah, and he's decided to go the opposite direction. He's not going where God told him to go. He's going in the opposite direction. And as he goes in the opposite direction, he thinks he's running away from God. In fact, the Bible says that he told the sailors that his God made all the land and all the water. But he thought he could run away from God. So he's running away. And then there's a great storm, and they throw him off. And then here's our picture. The Bible says that God sent a great fish to swallow him up so that he wouldn't drown. And then you know what the fish did? He stayed in there for 3 days. And while he was in the belly of that big fish, the Bible says Jonah prayed, God, deliver me. And you know what happened? The fish swam close to the beach. And the fish spit him out. Wow. I don't think that sounds a little gross to me, doesn't it, you? Actually, the Bible says, and this is what the Bible says, so I'm just going to say it. It says he vomited him up on the beach. Yuck. That's yuck. But there he is. He's on the beach. And then God comes to him the next time and he says, I want you to go to that place I told you to go to before. And you know what he does this time? He goes to the place. And it's a really neat story, and there's a lot more to it. The thing I want you just to think about is you really never can run away from God. There's nowhere you can go. Even if you're on a ship and it's all tossed around and you're feeling lost, you won't be away from God. God will be there too. Even if you feel like you're in the deepest place of the ocean, way, way away from anybody that can help you, God can be there too. It's pretty neat. And that fish was mean, but God used a fish to bring a good thing, right? It does look like a whale. That's what everybody thinks about is a big fish being a whale. But the Bible didn't say for sure. So I want you all to think about that. Wherever you go in life, whatever you face, whatever happens to you at school, your house, anything, I want you to know that you can never be anywhere that God won't be. God will always be there with you, okay? And if you need God, all you have to do is to pray, and God will be right there with you, okay? All right. Thank y'all. I appreciate it. God bless you.
The offertory hymn for the morning is hymn number 399. 399, Higher Ground. She'll find you. There you go, sugar. There you go. We're going to sing the first, third, and last stanzas. First, third, and last of 399. Stand with us, please, as we sing.
us stand for doxology, please.
Oh.
like to officially re-welcome the Messers back to Williams. We're glad your whole clan is here, except for Christopher, of course. He's not able to be here, but we're glad all of you are here. And I hope you get a chance to meet them and catch up with them after church today. If you're new to our church, Lee, right there in the suit, was our minister of education for several years here. And normally, I told him this morning, if I'd known you were coming, you could have done announcements and children's story, just like the old days. And I would have relished that, getting to hear you. Don't bark in church, right? So it's good to see you. You all look great. And Katie is newly married and glad to welcome you into the family and to Williams here. Good to see y'all. You look great. Also, I wanted to call a little attention to Garrett Preston today. Garrett broke a toe and part of his foot, I guess, in football game Friday night, and he finished out the game on that broken toe. I thought did a great job, showed a lot of courage, and I know it was hurting him. And now here he is taking up the offering on Sunday morning at church. But he'll be wearing that boot for a while and be out of football for a while. We'll be praying for you and hope that you have a good, speedy recovery, Garrett. Today we're going to continue on our series of sermons I've been doing on stories from the Bible that people in a past generation all knew fairly well, and maybe people today don't know as well. So we're learning and relearning those stories. And today we're going to look at the very well-known story of olden days called Jonah and the whale. Even though the Bible never mentions the word whale, we just sort of fill in the blank. It had to be a big fish. And even the artist drawing that I showed there, one of the kids said, that looked like a great fish. It looked like a whale to me. So let's hear the story. It's in the book of Jonah, one of the 12 minor prophets in the Old Testament, in the latter parts of our Old Testament. Jonah chapter 1, as we begin that story, in verse 1. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid his fare and went on board to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and such a mighty storm came upon the sea that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid, and each cried to his God. They threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. Jonah, meanwhile, had gone down into the hold of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. The captain came and said to him, what are you doing, sound asleep? Get up, call on your God. Perhaps the God will spare us a thought so that we will not perish. The sailors said to one another, come, let us cast lots so that we may know on whose account this calamity has come upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, tell us why this calamity has come upon us. What is your occupation? Where do you come from? What is your country? And of what people are you? I am a Hebrew, he responded. I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Then the men were even more afraid and said to him, what is this that you have done? For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them so. Then Jonah said to him, what shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us? For the sea was growing more and more tempestuous. He said to them, pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great storm has come upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring the ship back to land, but they could not fight against it, for the sea grew more and more stormy against them. Then they cried out to the Lord, please, O Lord, we pray, do not let us perish on account of this man's life. Do not make us guilty of innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. So they picked Jonah up and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord even more, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made their vows. But the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. And this is God's word for us this morning. And of course, the story of Jonah and the great fish is one that has intrigued people for many, many years. It is a story that has sometimes been labeled the reluctant prophet. I think reluctant is a sort of a mild way to put what Jonah decided to do when God gave him a command to prophesy, to preach, and to proclaim to the great city of Nineveh. If we ask folks on the street, probably the thing that would jump out about the book of Jonah in the Old Testament is what you all said when I asked you. It's the story of Jonah and the whale. A lot of folks on the street would say, I know the story of Jonah in the book of the Bible called Jonah. It's about Jonah and the whale. Even though the whale is never mentioned in the book, and it only has three verses, the fish has three verses out of 84. This book about Jonah and the whale is really about a lot of other stuff as well. One writer talked about this story, and he said that the message that a lot of people would come away with from what they know about Jonah is not only is there Jonah and a whale, but the message is you better not disobey God because bad things could happen to you. Until you get right with God, nothing's going to be good for you. This is a poem that this writer quotes. It's a children's poem written anonymously by some parent, I'm sure. Children, when you disobey, remember this tale. When you run from God's call, look out for the whale. There are animals to catch you on sea or land, and children are swallowed much easier than man. That's a scary poem, isn't it? Don't need the boogeyman, we just need the Jonah and the whale story. No. If you can imagine this story, it's a story really written for the people of God, and it is almost unbelievable that it makes it in the Bible because it's an indictment against God's people who choose not to do God's will. In the story, we're going to need to understand some background, and part of the background is that the people that Jonah comes from, I am a Hebrew, he says, the chosen people of God. And why were they chosen? They were chosen, the Bible says, in order to be a blessing to all the peoples, all the nations of the earth. And yet for many, many of the chosen people, they began to relish their part of the blessing and to ignore their command or their commission to go and share and be a blessing to those who were not chosen to be a part of the nation. This book was probably written after a great war has occurred where the whole northern part of Israel was destroyed by the Assyrian Empire, and they will cease to exist. They will be completely destroyed. And sometimes people think about the lost tribes of Israel. That's where that sort of comes from. The northern kingdom in 722 BC is destroyed and will never exist again as a nation until 1948 when the nation of Israel is recreated after World War II. Now imagine that you're writing a story against the country, the nation, that did that to you, and you're writing it after they've done all that, so you hate them, but you're going to set the story before that war. And in the story, you're going to have one of your prophets be told by God to go to that place, and the prophet says, I know what's going to happen. God says he's going to get rid of Nineveh, that capital city of Assyria, but really what God's going to do is offer a chance for them to have mercy. This is after, you're reading this after all the wars happened, and you hate those enemy people. So everybody who's reading this story initially are thinking, I'm with Jonah. I do not want to go to my enemy and say to my enemy, God is offering you a chance to be a part of God's big family. And so the people who read this story would have said, Jonah, that's exactly what I would have done. I just don't know if I could go to those kinds of people. Nineveh in the 8th century B.C. was the greatest, most powerful city on the face of the earth. The people from Nineveh ruled and defeated the armies of Egypt, even. Today, there's just a ruin or a big mound, and there's a big brick wall that goes 8 miles around the ruins of the city of Nineveh. It's sort of interesting in the cuneiform writing that describes Nineveh, the sort of symbolic writing. You know, you've probably seen the stuff on the pyramids and the stuff around Egypt with all those kind of writing that uses picture or Chinese writing that looks like pictures. Cuneiform writing was an ancient style of writing. And when it names the city of Nineveh, the two picture symbols that go together to make the word for Nineveh is enclosure for fish. Isn't that interesting? So who knows? Some people have said then that the book of Jonah is really a parable, like the ones Jesus told, to give us a very important message for our own lives. In the New Testament, Jonah's book is mentioned twice. Once, where Jesus says, on the last judgment, the people of Nineveh will rise up and they will convict you, because when they had a chance to repent, they recognized God and they turned from their evil ways. But when you see Jesus, when you see the Lord in your midst, you have chosen not to repent. You will be judged by the Ninevites. The second time, Jesus is asked to prove that he is God's son. And Jesus says, "You're a wily old folk, aren't you? All I will do is give you the sign of Jonah." Jonah was in the belly of the whale. How long? 3 days. And on the third day, he was actually spewed up, wasn't he? But he rose again, literally, out of the whale. The thing that is interesting about this story is when we don't know exactly where Jonah was when he gets his call from God to go to Nineveh. But if this was a map up here, let's say Jonah's right here, and here's Joppa, the seaport. Here's Jonah. Let's say right over here is Nineveh. This is where he's supposed to go. Jonah doesn't go this way. Jonah goes here to get a ship to go way over there into that pasture where the cows are. Way, way, way over there. Tarshish. Nobody knows for sure where Tarshish is. Most people today think it's in the southern tip of Spain. That's a long, long way to go on the Mediterranean Sea. Some say it's in India. Who knows? Some say it's just a word that means to get as far away as you can from where you are. This is the thing that I notice about it, and something I want you to think about too, is when God called Jonah, Jonah just got up and went the opposite way without ever talking it over with God. And that's something you and I do a lot, isn't it? We just go our own way because we don't want to do that, or we don't feel like doing that, or it's really hard to do that, and so we would just rather go our own way. And that's understandable. Everybody reading Jonah the first time, they're going to say, "I'm with Jonah. I feel like I could probably do that. I don't know how I could go to our enemies and give them a message of grace." I understand Jonah. But what Jonah doesn't do, and what a lot of us don't do, is to talk to God about our feelings. You ever do that? You sort of feel led to do some things. There's things you need to do. There's complex issues you've got to work through in your relationships or your life. Or maybe it's just making decisions. What should you do? Do you ever talk to God about that? Jonah does not. He does not enter into any dialogue with God. He just makes his own mind up to do what he wants to do. And it ends up putting in jeopardy all of the people on the boat. In fact, the rabbis, when they retold this story, said, "This boat is filled with a representative from the 70 known nations of that time. All the peoples of the world are represented on the boat. And Jonah's decision to do it his own way jeopardizes the blessing of the nations." You ever do that? You ever just do it your own way without consulting God? This is where I see it a lot for people. They make judgments on situations. They look at stuff and they make their minds up and say, "That's how that person is. This is how these people are. This is the situation," and they make a judgment. But I'm just asking you to consider that as a Christian, as a follower of God, our decisions and our judgments and our actions should be informed out of a prayerful dialogue with God, shouldn't it? We should be going to the Lord first. How many times, even in church, do we have committee meetings and we forget to pray before we do the business of the church? How many times have you huddled around with your friends and talked about things about the world and politics and what should be done in the community, what should be done, whatever? And can you honestly say that you are talking out of a prayerful, informed dialogue with the Lord? How many times have you sat around the table with your family and you're trying to figure out how you should go as a family, what you should do and how you should act, but you forget to pray? I'm just simply saying to you, and here's the story of Jonah. You can go to Nineveh, and God will be there. And in Nineveh, it will be very difficult. That's where you're called to go, and it will be some situations you'll get in, and you don't want to be there, but you got to go there. Just know you won't be alone. And so as you go, and while you're there, you can talk to God about that and help God, help get the help that God offers you. Or you can choose to go the opposite way, but even if you're in the opposite direction from where God wants you to go, or even if you're in the ship that's storming and rocking, even if you've been thrown overboard, God will hear your prayer there too. There's nowhere you can go. I like that. If you're fleeing away from God, you can't do it. God will always be readily available to hear you. If you've been tossed aboard off somewhere that you don't want to be in a situation you didn't choose, but there you are, take heart. You can still bring that to God. It's one of the great messages, I think, of the story of Jonah. Jonah goes the opposite direction. There's Nineveh. He heads over for Larry's pasture. And he gets into the boat going to Tarshish, way out there. And as he gets into the boat, they head out, these sailors, and the storm comes, and it's a terrible storm. And he tells them, they say, "Who are you?" And he says, "I'm running away from God." And they say, "Well, I've got a God too. It doesn't matter. I said, I want to run away from my God too. I got him on the mantle at the house. It's a little idol. And I understand that. Let's get as far away from his mountain as we can. And I think you can do the same thing." So they get on the boat, and they're running away, and they're going out there on the ocean. All this stuff happens, and then the big storm comes, and they go to him, and they says, "Look, we're all praying to our gods. You need to wake up and start praying to your God. Because right now, anybody who answers us will be very helpful. It's a bad situation." So they all start praying, and they get him together, and they ask him about the situation, and he says, "It's my fault. I'm the reason that all of this stuff is happening to you." When the rabbis told this story to try to help Jewish people understand it, they said that the sailors were very reluctant to throw him in, and we heard that in the story, didn't we? God don't hold this against us. Are we sure this is what we shouldn't do? We don't want to throw people over. So in the rabbis telling of the story, what they do is they say they tie a rope around Jonah and they dip his feet in, and the water all of a sudden gets calm. And they pull him up, and they say, "Hey, this might work." And then they say, "Look, it gets stormy again." So they dip him down to his waist, and it gets calm again. They pull him up, and a third time, they say, "Jonah, you got to go. It's working. Every time we put you in the water, and sorry, buddy, but we've got, you know, we want to live. We don't want this ship to sink." And so he gets into the water, and in three verses, we're told that God sends a rescuing animal, fish, whale, to swallow him up, and in the belly of the whale, the fish, Jonah prays a prayer of thanksgiving. And I'm not sure if he's thankful because at one point and later on, he's so obstinate and stubborn. I know none of God's people are ever that way today, but back then they had stubborn God's people. And he was so stubborn and so angry and wanted to do it his own way, that when he's in the well, I wonder sometimes if his Thanksgiving prayer was, "Thank goodness it's finally going to be over." Even later on in the book of Jonah, he says, "I'd rather die than these people come to the Lord. I'd rather die." Or maybe he's just feeling lucky, blessed, that he didn't drown. "Thank you, God, because I know that you are a God that delivers people in any situation, even the most hopeless situations you can imagine." And he prays that prayer, and then God has the whale spit him up on land, and then Jonah gets his second chance to go to that great city, Nineveh. And then he goes to Nineveh, and he preaches one of Mike Duncan's favorite sermons. Mike Duncan has often told me, my favorite sermons are short and sweet and hard to beat. He loves Bob Ford. So the sermon that's preached at Nineveh by the prophet is not really what God said. It's just a very simple sentence sermon. It simply says, 40 days more and Nineveh will be destroyed. Using the same Hebrew word for the earthquake that destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. This is a devastating destruction. 40 days more. And he's smiling as he preaches it. And Nineveh will be swallowed up and destroyed. And then a strange thing happens for that very short, sweet, hard-to-beat sermon. all the people, including the animals, repent. From the king to the lowliest stable animal, they repent. The animals are walking around with sackcloth and ashes on them. Everybody, from great to small, starts repenting and changing. And here's what I like about what they did. And it's something that I want to challenge you to consider. They heard the message and they said, "We have heard God." They didn't say, "Jonah, we heard you." They said, "We've heard God." And the message is not good, is it? 40 days are going to be destroyed. But they start living as if God will change that message, don't they? They start living as if they repent that God will not destroy them. That's a creative faith, and sometimes it's something that people lack in their lives. There's a place in 1 Corinthians where Paul says, "Why don't you all start living as though you had no wives or husbands at all? Start living as though you had no worries about your bank accounts and what's going to happen at all. Start living as though you had no entanglements or business dealings with the world at all, for the things of this world are soon passing away and will be no more." Can you live like that? Most people are too practical for that. The people of Nineveh were not too practical for that. When they hear God, they live as though God is a God of power and grace that can change their destiny and their future. They live as though they might not be destroyed, but that they might have a great future. They start changing and repenting. It's a beautiful story for them. They live as though this God is not some God that sits around one day you were born, and writes it all down in stone, day one to day last, and this is how everything's going to go for you. They live as though God is creatively at work in your life. Your destiny is not finished. It's not written in stone. You're not done. You may think that you're in the worst possible situation you could ever be in. Maybe you've done stuff in your life that's so bad and you feel like you'll never be able to be truly accepted by God. Or you know people like that and you put them in Nineveh because you know they're wicked. And the Bible says to us very clearly that you and I need to live as though that kind of stuff is never the end of the story. God can change things, rescue people from the deepest part of the ocean to the highest, worst city in the world. God can reach in and rescue you and give you a second chance in life. It's a wonderful story, but it won't happen, really, I don't think, unless you just start living as though it is possible. That's called living by faith. A lot of people today don't live by faith. They live by something that they think is written in stone. You do this, you get that. You do this, you get that. A, B, 1, 1. And God never works that kind of math. He never works that kind of stuff. It's always creative stuff. God doesn't wind the clock up of your life and says, "Now go. Start day is when you're born. End day is when you die." It's all sort of winding down. Never that way with God. God's always involved, always actively responding to you. They live as though if they repent and change, that God will redirect the destiny of their lives. Do you believe that? Do you believe there's a chance that whatever rut you're in now, whatever way your life's going now, that God could reach in there and get you out of that rut? And set you back on a new direction or a new path? We preach that and talk about that all the time, don't we? Jonah's story is telling us that the worst rut you could ever be in, the worst situation you could imagine, the most wicked place you could ever be in, is still not too far away for God to reach in there and to pull you up and give you a next chance in life. And I love that part of the story. In Jonah, many people have noticed that it's strange in that Jonah never says, like the other prophets, "Thus saith the Lord." Jonah just says his own thing. There's nothing in Jonah like the other prophets that in the end of time, God will set all this stuff straight. It's not said like that. But in Jonah, I hear, "Thus saith the Lord." And in Jonah, I hear, you and I are being challenged to live as though God will set everything straight in the end. Live as though you are a child of God. Live as though when you repent that God is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Live as though God is directly interested and present in your life, whether you're in the belly of the whale or on the stormy ship or heading in the right direction. It doesn't matter. Live as though you are a child of God. So Jonah gets his second chance, and he goes to Nineveh, preaches the quick sermon, they repent, and things truly change for Nineveh. And Jonah is extremely distressed about the situation. Jonah marches through the city, telling as many people as he can how God's going to destroy them all. They start repenting and changing and turning to God, and he goes on the mountain or the hill beside it, and he sits up there. And he says, "Man, it's hot, but I can't wait to how hot it's going to get down there." And the Bible says, and this is where it gets like a parable, a little plant grows up to be a big plant, has a shade, and he says, "Thank you, Lord, you gave me a shade so I can watch them all die." And then the Lord divinely appoints a worm to attack the plant, and the plant withers and dies. And Jonah says, in the words of Bobby Bowden, "Dadgummit. Lord, it's hot again, and I'm so mad about that, I can't believe my luck." And God says, "Wait a minute, you upset about that situation, what about this city? You care about them?" He says, "No, I don't have any pity for them. I care about me." And the Bible ends, as Jeremy read for us, God says, "You're worried and have pity on yourself. Shouldn't I have pity on all of this great city with all its people and even the cattle? Shouldn't I care about all of it?" And that's sort of the way that it ends. It's sort of an amazing thing. Jonah gets a second chance, but he doesn't put his heart into it, does he? I was watching All in the Family the other day. Some of you folks over a certain age know All in the Family. Archie and Edith Bunker. Archie was the head of the household there, or so he thought. Always did things his way. Very opinionated guy. One time in one of the shows that I saw, he had apologized to Edith because she was right. This is the way he did it. Sorry, I'm going to... She said, "What? What, Archie?" And he goes, "I'm sorry, you're right." And he just mumbles through it. And finally, he yells at her, "I'm sorry, Edith, you were right, and I was wrong." It's hard for us to do that, isn't it? It's hard for anybody to do that. Sometimes when we have to do stuff like that, the message gets a little jumbled, doesn't it? Because we don't want to do those things. And this is what happened with Jonah. He comes through there and sort of is ambiguous. He's not very clear as a prophet about what they should be doing. They have creative faith and that helps them, but otherwise it's just not very clear. The full message of God is not completely given to them. It's just the short and sweet, hard to beat part. You're going to die. And what happens in that story is what happens for a lot of us. He has been in the system of faith in the church for so long that he feels entitled to grace. "You better send me a plant, God, because I marched through this city. I did it. I didn't want to do it, God, but I did it. And I deserve a plant to shade me." He becomes entitled to grace while he's watching a whole city that he feels is not entitled to grace. And what's happened, and what happens for a lot of us, and what I want to challenge you to think about today is how far away have we gotten from the point of the amazing grace. You know that song, Amazing Grace? They used to say it was the Southern Baptist National Anthem. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Maybe if you ever hear that song, just think to yourself, "Lord, they're playing my song. They're playing my song. Because the further away you get from that moment when you were the wretch, undeserving, and yet God reached down to you and gave you that second chance, showed you mercy, forgave your sins, cleansed all your unrighteousness. When you get to that point, you can't wait for Nineveh to get to that point. You don't care if they're black, white, yellow, brown. You don't care what religion they come from, what creed they come from, how old they come from. You want them to have what you feel and know you have as a child of God. But when you get a long way away from it, what happens is you get rigid, you get ugly, you get judgmental, you get to feeling entitled, and when you stub your toe and it doesn't work out, you don't care about the guy who had his leg amputated. You're just worried about your toe because you feel entitled to God's grace instead of saying, God, it's amazing when you show me any grace at all. Where are you? When you get to feeling entitled, you really don't care about other people. Let me ask you to do this. Go back to that place for you, wherever it is in your story, where you felt that you could sing Amazing Grace from the top of your lungs and you didn't care who heard it. You'd stand in the water even though you're the shyest person in church and you would say to the preacher and hope everybody else heard it, I believe Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And then somebody says, then we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of Christ's death, raised to walk in the newness of life. And you don't care who hears it because you're ready to publicly say, I'm close to the grace right now, and I sure don't deserve it, but thank God I got it. And when you get to that place, you're ready to walk through Nineveh. You're ready to talk to the sailors. You'll jump off the boat if you have to. You'll go wherever it is God wants you to go because you're singing Amazing Grace and you're humming it in your heart all the time. What a wretch I am, but thank God He has accepted me and loved me. I was telling somebody this week, and we had the group from Highland Hills, and we fed them, as we always do. We have thousands of desserts, and I have to sample every one of them. And somebody made a banana pudding with coconut in it, and it was awesome. And I told them that when I was a young boy, we lived in a trailer, and across the street was my great-grandmother. We called her Old Grandmother. That's just what we called her, Old Grandmother. One of her daughters we called Aunt Tiny, and she ain't, and she wasn't. Country folks, you know, they come up with these nicknames. I know y'all have a few nicknames around here, too. So Old Grandmother called me every year on April 6th. She'd say, Mike? I say, yes, ma'am. What day is it? It's my birthday. I got something for you. Come across the street. And I come over there, and every year on my birthday, she'd make me a banana pudding. This is not really a hint, but if it works out, it's okay. It had bananas, strawberries, and coconut. Coconut being the emphasis for me. Put all that in there, and I'd go get that banana pudding. I'd go across the street, and I'd have to hide it from Mark, and he and I, you know, we'd wrestle over that banana pudding. But she never smiled. She would never smile. I don't ever remember Old Grandmother smiling. And I think she probably was sweet. She obviously cared about me to give me that banana pudding. But I never saw her smiling. I guess that was just her way. But boy, I wish she had smiled. Some people who are Christians are like that. I wish she'd smile. Lighten up. Get back in touch with grace. It's amazing, isn't it? It's so amazing that you have to feel joy for the lowliest sinner who accepts it. You have to feel pity for the Jonas who are sitting on the hills even today wishing that their toes would feel better and the heat wouldn't hit them so bad while a whole community is hurting and in need. I'm just asking you to consider Jonah's story and hear that you and I need to get back to that point of grace because the further away you get from it, the more uncaring you are. It's amazing grace, how sweet to sound. When Jonah's story is told, everybody thinks about it and says it's about a fish. About Jonah and the whale. It's really not, isn't it? Only three verses to Jonah and the whale. Jonah's story is about God. Jonah says, when he's sitting on that hill, God, I knew this would happen. I knew it, and that's why I didn't go. I know the Bible better than anybody in church. And I know you better than anybody in the church. And I knew if I went and told him at all anything about you, even a convoluted Archie Bunker sermon, anything at all about you, and if they could hear just a little bit of your voice, that they would repent and change, and you would change, and you would save them. And I don't like you saving people besides me. When Jonah is up there on that hill, he's saying to us, I know God. I know that you're full of steadfast love, ready to relent, ready to receive, ready to forgive, offering a second chance to any who want it. This is what I always wondered. The book ends. It's about a story, not of a whale or of a prophet who doesn't quite get it. It's a story of God, and that's how it made it in the Bible. It's a story of who God really is. And don't you ever forget it. God is ruled by a heart of compassion for the furthest, most wicked enemy you can imagine, for the deepest place that anybody can go, from the furthest destination away from the Lord. God is a compassionate Lord, and I pray that grace will always be the primary message preached from this pulpit in this church. I wonder, because the Bible just sort of ends in Jonah with a question from God, if God gave Jonah another chance. What do you think? You know, I've heard a lot of people always say, God's a God of second chances. And I believe that's true. Well, Jonah's on his second already. But I just bet you he gets a third chance, too. Because the God of Jonah, the God of the Bible, the God of our Savior Jesus, is a God who gives second chances, third chances, fourth chances. God is always ready to relent, to save, to show the steadfast love that's in God's heart. That's who we worship. The story of Jonah and the whale is a powerful story. Not of scaring our children to obey God because he's going to swallow you up, but telling our children every day of their lives that they are cherished by a God whose compassion rules the world. Amen. This moment of invitation, a chance for us as we stand and sing to respond to the things that God, our compassionate Lord, has been doing in your life and in mine and in our church. It's a chance for you to come here and pray if you need to make a decision to accept Christ as your Savior and receive that moment of amazing grace, or to make a rededication of yourself to the way of the Lord for you. Maybe you want to join our church. We always make this invitation available because it's always open for you. Come and share what you need to share this morning as the Lord leads you as we stand and sing.
202, Amazing Grace.
Singing our song. Thank you for being here today. Prayer now for our benediction, the Lord's Prayer.
Father,